Thank you so much, Saleem, for agreeing to be part of Project Bolo. I am really honored and delighted to be speaking to you. Saleem, which year were you born and which city was your childhood spent in?
I was born in 1951, in August, in Lucknow. Spent the first 17 years here, in two different schools, and then had to leave Lucknow. Because by then I knew I was different and I couldn't have survived in the small town, so Delhi was the obvious option.
Lucknow is known for large joint families. What about yours?
Oh, it was a huge family. It was, you know, I come from a family that's making its transition from feudalism to whatever, not capitalism, but a modern state of mind, and we came from a very large extended family. The Kidwais are like a tribe. And of course, now, after all these years, I see the advantages of it and how that can be used to your advantage and how it can be used to support you. But it can also be very, very restricting when you're younger. And by moving away from Lucknow, I thought I freed myself from that. And I'm glad I did for a brief period of time.
When did you first realize about your attraction towards men?
I think the first stirrings of any sort of sexual things, as far as I can remember, whether it was pictures on calendars or pictures in magazines, or I mean, I was attracted to the male form, absolutely. I mean, it took for time for it to crystallize and become, but I don't think I can put a date to it.
But I mean, in a sense,
there was no event that shaped it. Yeah, right, no, yeah. No.
But were you able to share what you felt? Did you have any close friends or confidants in your early childhood?
Childhood, no. I mean, if you're talking about sharing the thing, yes. I mean, playing around from the doctor stage to right into school, senior school. But I don't think we talked about it. The thing of having a gay friend where you discuss not only your feelings to each other, but others, you know, you discuss other men or your attraction to other men. That happened only in Delhi. Once I went to college in Delhi, that began. And that happened again early, 17 or 18. Because I knew I was gay by the time I was 17. And I understood what it was about.
Mm-hmm. Did you feel anxious or did you feel worried in any way? Did it bother you?
No, it didn't bother me. I mean, what I was anxious about and what I felt traumatized about was when I first thought what I thought was when I first fell in love, when I felt an extreme painful attraction towards someone. But I mean, looking back, it was quite a pleasurable experience, you know, that's going through it. I mean, it was pain, but a lot of pain is fun, you know.
Words. Were there any words that you could identify with? I mean, a word which described what you felt.
Discovered the word homosexual very early in life. I had heard, even read about in word from Ellis and all those words because I read a lot.
How early was that, sorry?
I would say 15, I had found The Psychology of Sex. So where they talked about sexual inversion in word. That didn't stick in my mind. I didn't use myself the word invert. But I remember coming across the word homosexual in one of Pearl Buck's book, of all places. She'd be shocked that that's how I discovered, or that's where the word sticks in my mind from. And I knew that is what I was.
That was even before you moved to Delhi, right?
Yeah, before I moved to Delhi. This was still in school. I moved to Delhi when I was 17, so this all happened before that.
And what did you study in Delhi?
I didn't want to do sciences. I didn't want to do the normal engineering medicine routine. I wanted to study history. I got into St. Stephen's and those decisions were made very easily. It was no problem, actually.
Okay, one more question related to this. Where did you study when you moved to Delhi?
I studied history at St. Stephen's College. It was an all-male institution then. It wasn't co-ed then. It was very different from what I had been used to. I was a small city boy. St. Stephen's was full of people from all the fancy public schools and full of people who came in groups and full of jocks. So I felt very isolated in the beginning there. I felt very isolated, I felt very lonely in the beginning, till I made friends.
At the college, was there any sort of male bonding?
Yeah, lots of it was going on, lots of it. Unbelievable how much was going on, how many affairs were going on, how much sex was happening. Lots of it, yeah. I mean, I could take names of a lot of people who are important now. Public figures, yeah. I mean, from college, who I know stories about. Yeah.
I see. Were there any public places where people met, like parks or?
You see, the parks I found a little later, and parks were intimidating if you're alone. I learnt about park from someone I'd met because. You know, you didn't know anyone else around. You have one or two bad experiences. So, you know, I don't want to go into the seamy side, but there are stuff. There was stuff happening there. I mean, the Connaught Place Park, for instance, as I was to discover, you met a lot of people. All of us were there. You made friends. As we came to know a larger group, you run in and catch up with news and all sorts of things happening, but there were also hustlers and there were also blackmailers and there was also cops. People who robbed you, you know, I mean, you know, the New Delhi railway station was very close by. So what would happen is that people would pick up and there was always a problem of space. So very often people would walk down there and go into the trains that were parked in the shed and go into the empty compartments and use that for sex. And people were robbed there, you know, at knife point or even razor blades. And I mean, horrible stories. But not as to say that was the only side. There were a lot of people who were having good sex and stuff there. But there's also this element was there all along. And this has been common. I mean, I later discovered from someone that he had been cruising in the Connaught Place Park during the World War. But that has been, public places have always been that. I mean, after when I was researching the book and discovered that markets and parks and have from the 14th, 15th century have been doing that and even earlier. Anywhere where males collect, this is bound to happen. It happens today. It's natural, you know.
So, did you start reading literature or books with queer themes?
Yeah, I was doing history honors, so my concentration was studying history of every civilization, practically America and Europe, China, India. So you're studying it in more detail, and as you're reading, you find lots of things that strike you and say that, oh, there's something here. There's your own gay dao working, you know, that there's something here. And all those things, as time went on, I started flagging them, you know, making notes, then filing, then cutting, then you know how one accumulates. And that's where I think later the idea of the book came from, that both Ruth and I had been doing similar things.
When was the time you went abroad? It was a turning point in your life, right?
I finished my MA in 1973 and got hired immediately by Delhi University. So I was 21 plus when I began teaching. And luckily Delhi University had an option that we could get study leave to do our PhDs. So in 1976, I went off to Canada, ostensibly to do a PhD, but basically I wanted to be in a gay environment. You know, I mean, I just wanted to get out, see what buzz. You know, I mean, it was just not even 10 years after Stonewall. You know, it was just, the whole thing was just blooming. And
So how was the scene?
Oh, it was hugely, hugely different. You know, for instance, just the gay bars, you know. Hundreds of people in every gay bar, dozens of bars, and all sorts of bars. I mean, specific bars, you know, bars where there were older people interested in younger people, younger people interested in older people, the leather bars, the, you know, I mean, the discos, it was a big, it was Saturday Night Fever time, so the discos were very, very big. So there were, you know, you could take your pick as to what sort of bar you went on. You know, I mean, just walking into a bar full of people, learning the etiquette, you know, the etiquette of pickup, exchanging glasses, you know, I mean, how do you actually function? And in that, I was sort of very, very lucky to having met Sunil Gupta in the year I arrived in 1976. He was from Montreal, but he was living in New York and would come to Montreal very often. And he literally sort of led me by the finger and showed me the bars and how to work them, and introduced me to his friends with whom I would then became like a group and would go out. And so in that way, it was very different, and I learned a lot, you know, the whole business of socializing in the gay scene, socializing with men, gay men that you weren't sleeping with, was something that I experienced for the first time there. Before that, here the only gay men you were interacting with were people you were having some sort of contact with, some sort of romantic or sexual or emotional contact with.
And what about the drag scene?
In Canada, you know, I mean, of course, drag was a big entertainment thing. So that was where I was exposed to drag and saw some great drag shows. Every, you know, a lot of bars had performers, and I met transsexuals for the first time there. I met an Egyptian transsexual. It was a very funny story, very touching story. Then I met a much older transsexual who had fought in the World War as a pilot, and then had an operation in Morocco. But something happened there that radically altered my life, you know, and it's something that I hadn't planned for, but it was horrible, but in a way I'm very glad it happened. Now, I don't talk about it really, very often, but in 1977, I was in a bar and that bar got busted. And I was arrested for being a found-in in a body house. And it was horrible, you know, I mean, being in jail. And I've written a piece on it, which has been published in Tricone. But it meant that I was under trial for the remaining period of my life in Canada. And periodically, we'd have court dates. And it was very humiliating. And I was a foreign student. I was on a student visa. So there was this constant threat of being deported. And that was very scary. And I mean, that was the worst period of being gay and being harassed and being humiliated and feeling low about yourself. And so it meant that a lot of things became very clear in my thing. And what the most important thing was that the West is not an answer, does not have an answer. And I would have to fight. Things would have to change for the world to get better, for my world to get better. And if I had to do anything to it, I'd rather do it in my own country. I wasn't able to do it there as a foreigner, as an alien. So the decision was made for me.
And Saleem, what did you do after coming back to India?
I came back and I rejoined my job. You see, I had taken those 4 years off. And I came back in 19, 1980, and so 1981 I rejoined work, and it was a different Delhi, and I think Canada made a difference, because while I was in Canada I visited home, and on one of those trips I met up with a group of people, and these were also some people that Sunil had known before he migrated, some old school friends, and people he had met on his visit. So for the first time there was a group of people who we started meeting, and the common interest was our sexuality, our sexual preference, and a social scene emerged, and the social scene was this party, not party so much as get-together scene. Now this get-together thing was very fluid and very erratic. It depended on who had space when. When was space available? Someone's wife going away or someone's parents going away, and they had some people would collect and make do with the space, or someone's office. I mean, it's all sorts of random places we'd gather in and meet. At least I, and at various points in time, met different people who would say, yeah, let's take the scene out of the park, let's take it out of the dark, let's take it out of the place where people don't have to invent names. The group had started getting bigger, and I remember those parties, by the third year we had to stop them because suddenly there were so many people. And this we're talking about by the late 80s, you know, and we had started searching for bars where we could have one sort of a weekly gay night, that it was very important politically to have a social party space, because give gay people that freedom, and we're talking 10 years ago and things change very fast, that you create that space and you'll have a lot more people politicized in protecting that space. They might not be there for rights or civil rights or human rights or whatever, but they want their party space and they'll fight for it. And it worked that way. I mean, if you look at Pride and everything, it's important to have that. It's not only about politics and resolutions and dhannas and demonstrations. Pleasure has to be very much part of your politics. And on that principle of the socializing thing, I think the community grew. It was helped by a lot of people. One person I would, it'd be remiss not to mention, it was Siddharth Gautam, who, being as young and charismatic as he was, brought a lot of life and a lot of dynamism to the party.
Okay, of course you had this partying and political talk on one side, but was it also falling in love, falling out of love?
All the time. That was, you know, I mean, that's normal, isn't it? It happened, you know, falling in love happened till the mid-90s. In the mid-90s, you know, I mean, this is fire happened that time. So, I mean, the personal and the larger history, if you look back, seems to have sort of crossed at certain points. And my personal life changed since then. I mean, I was a partier of much more, as you said, falling in love, getting involved, or getting all sorts of things. And then you sober up, you know, you hit your mid-40s, you start looking at other things. Other things become more important to you.
And was there pressure to get married from your family?
I turned 30 in 1981. You know, my father had passed away in 1976. When I was 25, and the issue of marriage hadn't come, though it was very much on his mind. I later learned that he had even decided, or he had an opinion about who I should get married to, etc. And if he had been around, I would have had a battle. But I would have taken it on like I took on other things. But since he passed, the pressure eased off considerably, because my mother did at times express again the thing, you know, desire that grandchildren, marry, and I'm alone. But the fact that I'd come out to my sisters helped a great deal, because they deflected the pressure. No, I did not have excruciating this thing. I mean, there was a lot of pressure. I mean, believe it or not, it continues till today. You know, you meet older relatives and say, why not get married? Now you're ill, you should have someone to look after you, etc., etc. You know, you, except for laughing in their faces, you can't do a thing. But that sort of pressure continues. But it's not something I can't handle. Even then, earlier I handled it, and now I can handle it.
When did you come out, and how did it happen?
It was like everything else, it was a process. It wasn't sort of patak, you know. I mean, when I came out to my elder sister, she said, I always knew. I didn't have to tell my nephews that I'm gay. They knew. Some people I told, some people I didn't have to tell. What I never did was to go through this whole marriage business or pretend otherwise, you know. I mean, I might not have said to people that I'm gay, but I never pretended I was straight either. So it was a question of lying by keeping silence, but also telling the truth by keeping silence.
Saleem, during this period in the 80s, were there any gay organizations in Delhi?
Since the 80s, there were lots of attempts to take a discussion, a meeting, create some sort of a meeting ground. In Indian Coffee House, I remember there were times when two of us would be sitting there for two evenings, three evenings, or three Saturdays, and no one turning up. And suddenly, when the weather changed and things were nice in the end of April, March, April, 15, 18 people would come from the park and then disappear because they realize that this is not, people just sit and talk, nothing is happening here, no one's picking up. So this went on and it picked up speed. And as younger people came along, you know, people like Siddharth Gautam. And I remember many, many such occasions, you know, meetings in Nehru Park, meetings in Lodi Gardens, meeting in Coffee House, even Central Park. This attempt to meet and discuss. And Red Rose was one of those. And therefore, I think, you know, by early 90s, enough attempts had been made, unsuccessful attempts had been made to organize, that when finally an issue was available around which there could be gathering around a political issue, that is fire, things were ready. And from mid-90s onwards, we see groups, and ABBA was one such group. I mean, it was never a sexuality group, but it wasn't even gay. But, you know, Siddharth Gautam being in there, sexuality became very much a part of it. And I think ABBA was the first successful group. The petition they did for decriminalizing 377 was almost the same as the one that was eventually heard before the courts and on which the court order came, except that ABBA is lost. I mean, no one realizes or mentions that this process was begun by ABBA.
You said you came back from Canada and started teaching again, I think in the 1980s or 90s, and you're always open about your sexuality, right? So did it affect in any way your interaction with your colleagues or your students?
You know, this whole process of, as we were talking earlier, of coming out or being out, was a gradual process. It didn't happen one day. Over a period of time, I came out to more and more people, including students, some students, former students, till I left. I left in 93. So everyone who was close to me, everyone who was a friend of mine, colleague or former student or even some current student, I was gay, I hadn't announced it in the sense that I wasn't making public statements, but I was fully involved being gay. It wasn't stopping me from doing anything that I was doing, including getting involved with people or my social activities. I never faced any problems.
Saleem, now we come to another important chapter in your life, the book Same Sex Love in India. How did that come about?
Ruth was also teaching at Delhi University in another college. She was in Miranda House, and we knew about each other before we met each other. And finally, when we met, it took some time to become friends because I was in the process of leaving the university. She was at that point of time going abroad post her PhD, and in about 94, we met up again when she returned, and we started discussing, as among other things, the research that both of us had done till then, and looked at each other's materials that we had. And it was clear that both of us individually had thought of doing something like that. But our expertise was in certain areas, you know. Mine was medieval India, Urdu-based material, Persian-based materials. She had the advantage of knowing Sanskrit, her Hindi was better, her interest in Hinduism. So it was very obvious that our works complemented each other and the thing. And as people, and we got along very well, you know, I mean, because that was the beginning of a partnership that lasts to the.
Tell me, Saleem, what did you hope to achieve with the book?
What we tried to achieve was, you know, to look at the issue of sexuality and to find its presence in our culture and civilization. And the approach that we followed, because we knew we'd be attacked, that we had to be on very, very firm ground. So we made a rule that we would only include stuff that had already been, that was available in print already. That was available either. We weren't going to just, it wasn't going to be a book only of interpretation. So it, what we were trying to show, and we did successfully show, is that, you know, I mean, same-sex attraction was something that had been acknowledged, written about, discussed for 2,000 years in India. And it wasn't that whole argument that this was a foreign import and it is against our tradition and culture.
So, what changes have you seen of late?
Some changes, of course, are pleasant. Some changes, everything has its downside, as I said. I find people suddenly there's less self-reflection amongst gay people. Not that I'm saying that as a generation we were superior, but we were forced to reflect on our situations much more than people today. I think the closet has become much bigger. The net has created its own cyber closet, which is so real in some ways, and people can make it so real that it's less of an incentive for people to come out.
And what was your reaction when the Delhi High Court came up with the verdict on Section 377?
A few friends a day earlier called and said, aren't you coming tomorrow? You should be in Delhi. And I said, no. I knew, in my heart of hearts, I knew what was coming. Because I attended the hearings. So I knew that we were getting a favorable response. So it wasn't as if I was dying to be there to see, find out kya hoga, kya hoga. On the other hand, you know, if I was to look at my reaction, there were two parts of it. One was I missed people who are not here anymore, people who would have loved to see this day, people for whom this day was important, who were an important part of our history, our struggle. Maybe it's not said or things. So it was a very personal thing. And the other thing was also personal, is a big deal. It makes no difference to me. Of course, it's a great achievement. I mean, that was all given, you know. I mean, that was given in the fact that I'd attended the hearings, I'd been so much involved in what was going on. And it was also, in one way, I think a turning point personally for me, is that I knew that I could withdraw now. I could sort of retreat now. There were enough people. I mean, just the case in itself had radicalized so many people and created such a huge cadre. You know, there were times when there was almost no one willing to speak. Suddenly there were so many people, so many voices, so many opinions, people willing to write, to speak, to march, to be present in the court, that one felt hamari zimmedari khatam. This younger lot can take over.
So Saleem, if you reflect back, what has been the most happiest moment in your life? That one thing that made you so, so, so happy?
The happiest moments, the most fruitful moments, the most fulfilling moments have been private moments. And I've been very lucky to have my share of them. And that's a good thing to have, because all the ugliness, the hurt, the disappointments in life, one forgets. And one aims to forget. And it's only the positive moment one remembers. And luckily they've been enough to keep me, my nostalgia, positive. I mean, I look back, I don't think I had a wasted life. Or there's something I could have done better. Of course, we could all have done better, but I'm happy where I am.
Any moments of regret?
I mean, if I was to believe in rebirth, I would want to be born gay, believe it or not. I know that's considered, a lot of people say, no, never again. No, I'm not a masochist, but I've had fun.
That's a great note to end on. Thank you so much, Saleem. It's been a real privilege.